Welcome, everybody. It's lovely to see you all here. I would like to formally open this morning session on the right to be forgotten rulings. It is the first of two workshops. The second one is workshop 142 this afternoon. This is workshop 31. We have entitled it The Right to be Forgotten Rulings and Their Implications. And I have an extremely expert and diverse panel here. We also will be having an interactive session, so I just want to warn everybody who is in the room that you will be forming breakout groups in the second half, okay? So just to warn you. And that will take about 20, 25 minutes, but I will explain the format shortly. My name is Marianne Franklin. I am Professor of Global Media and Politics at Goldsmiths University of London in the UK. I'm also here representing the Internet Rights and Principles Coalition and as chair of the GigaNet network. But today we're primarily here to discuss what these particular rulings that have been given the name The Right to be Forgotten mean for a number of concerns. And it's a set of rulings, not just one ruling, a set of rulings around the world that pretty much resonate with the social, the cultural, the political, the economic, and the technical aspects to internet governance. So all the aspects are implicated in how judges are ruling and how people are deciding what happens to content and how content is linked. So this particular workshop discusses the legal, technical, and societal implications of these decisions in the European Union and elsewhere, particularly for internet design, access, and use. Now, this workshop this morning will focus on the procedural and legal implications of such rulings. It's part, as I said, of this cross-collaboration with workshop 142, which will look at specific case studies from around the world. Now, in this workshop, we will be addressing challenges arising from terminology, implementation, and due process. For first, the legal applicability or inapplicability within and beyond national and regional jurisdictions. Number two, commercial and technical challenges of implementing a ruling. Number three, the societal implications for the public interest when hyperlinked online content is deleted, delinked, or delisted. So again, terminology will be a factor in our discussion. Now, the human rights implications of implementation include freedom of expression, the right to access to information, privacy and personal data handling, and accountability issues. Specific issues, as we say, apart from terminology, will be who decides, in what context, and by what process, what content and which actors gain or lose from such rulings, and do these decisions account for overlaps between public-private figures and their public-private lives? And here we will be looking at different levels of complexity. And of course, the technical issues, limits to how you delete or de-link, what a database is or is not, ownership and control of data logs, and how these capabilities may be misused or misunderstood. Okay, and of course, we're dealing with limits in application so as not to harm access to information, issues around how we keep the historical record complete and not distort it, and issues, of course, across history about how sometimes these sorts of rulings may, in fact, unwittingly obscure the means by which accountability for past human rights violations can be substantiated. So an enormously complex area. It's a new area for debate, so welcome for joining us in this. So there are four objectives, and I need to say this several times because it's part of your great breakout group exercise. The first objective for today is to agree in some way on a clearer precision from the above points and to create more precision in a particular area of these discussions. Secondly, to try and outline a set of judicial principles, if possible, for implementing these decisions and to make respective recommendations for future rulings if your breakout group is feeling brave enough. And number four, to decide, hopefully, on a more appropriate name for such decisions. Are these decisions about the right to be forgotten? Is this the right name? Okay. So for the first half, we'll have opening statements from our panelists, who I will introduce shortly, about 20 minutes, 25 minutes, with some discussion. And then we're going to have the breakout group in the second half, and our panelists have agreed to be rapporteur for the breakout groups. So they will be working with you all around the room to look at those four objectives, which I will repeat. And then we're going to reconvene for reporting back briefly, a little bit of a discussion, and then we'll sum up, and then it's time for coffee. Okay, a lot to do, but I know we can manage it. Okay. I would also like to welcome on remote participation a group of undergraduate students from Syracuse University, the Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs at Syracuse, and they're joining us by remote hub. And they've been extraordinarily engaged and active on the DC main session output material on the IGF website. And they're here with questions, and they'll be taking part in our discussion. Okay, thank you very much. So, without further ado, allow me to introduce on my right Mr. Pedro Les Andrada, who represents the Google Corporation, the Latin America, based in Argentina, am I correct? On my second, right at the end of the table, excuse me, I'm sorry for that, Mr. Sergio Branco from the Institute of Technology and Society in Rio de Janeiro. Next to Pedro is Mishi Chowdhury, Software Freedom Law Center, New York, but also India. Ms. Kelly Kim from the Open Net in Korea. Mr. Pedro Vaca from the Foundation for Freedom of the Press, Colombia. And directly next to me, Mr. Hernan Valles, who's from the Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights. So we have a very distinguished panel. So I'm going to start in order of alphabetical order. It's the most democratic form of hierarchy we have. So I'm going to open the floor to Pedro. All the speakers will keep to 3 minutes because we've got plenty of time to open our discussion up as we go. Thank you, everyone, for allowing me to be a very strict timekeeper. Pedro, you have 3 minutes, starting from now.
Thank you. Can we have the presentation on? So first of all, welcome, good morning. And I would like to give you a little bit of background of what this is about. And in order to start the discussion, I know that many of you are very well aware of about the judgment, but I don't know if all of you know what started this case. So this case was started because of what you see there. You see there the page in the newspapers in Spain. It's called La Vanguardia. That is a newspaper. That is a page from 1998. There is what is highlighted in red is a small official publication that is mandatory by law, telling that there was going to be an auction of a property of Mr. Mario Costeja. And that happened in 1998. 10 years later, the newspaper decided to digitalize all its archive. And that makes this page available on the internet, and also subject to be indexed as well. So this tiny announcement is what triggered all this discussion on right to be forgotten. Remember, this is to publish this was mandatory by law. You know, every time that this happened, Mr. Coteja has an issue with his taxes. That's why his property was going to be sold by the judiciary. So this ends up in a court decision that, in a nutshell, basically forced search engines to start to take decisions on what should be information that should be published or what information should be publicly available. And this is something that for a private company is a great burden, because we are forced to take the role of the judiciary in this case. We need to evaluate what is something that could damage individuals' privacy or individuals' data protection. But we need to balance into the public interest and make an assessment whether this information is accurate, whether this information is up to date, And also, it's something that you cannot do automatically, so you need to hire hundreds and hundreds of professionals to look into this in order to assess what we do with this. Just to give you an example, this is the number of requests that we received about almost a year ago. So this is 228,000 requests that also points to 124,000 URLs that we have to evaluate. And you can see here the URLs that we have to take down or the delink, and the URLs that we decided not to delink. So just to give you an example of the magnitude of this kind of work. Okay, that is my time. One more thing is that this also triggered different bills in different countries really, really fast. Like weeks after the decision, we start to see different bills in Chile, also later on in Brazil or in Argentina. So this becomes also a global issue in some places. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pedro, for keeping to time. We will do another round. So now I'm going to move to our next speaker, Sergio Branco from Rio de Janeiro. Sergio, your 3 minutes are starting from now.
Okay, so I have to thank you very quickly, Marianne, so I can make my presentation, but I really need to thank Marianne for organizing everything. She's amazing. You have no idea how great she is in organizing things. Thank you very much. I have a short presentation that I divided into three parts. In the first one, I'd like to mention how the right to be forgotten was constructed in Brazil. What were the cases that made people think about the right to be forgotten? Some years ago, we had a TV show called Linha Direta, Direct Line. That was a kind of documentary program. And one of the documentaries was about a killing of poor children living on the streets that happened in Rio de Janeiro in 1993. And one man was accused of taking part in this killing, and he was considered not guilty. After some years, the TV show made this documentary saying that he was involved in the killing. And he sued the TV channel, and he won because he said that the story could be told without saying his name. The same program, after some years, made a documentary about the murder of this young woman. She was murdered in 1950 or 60, and her surviving brothers sued the program, saying that the program could not mention her name because it felt them suffer. But they lost because the court decided that it was impossible to tell the story without mentioning her name. So these are the two leading cases in Brazil about the right to be forgotten. And after the decision Pedro has just mentioned in the European Court, our Congress decided to start working on the right to be forgotten. And there are some bills of law that are extremely bad, as I can show you briefly. One of them says that it's mandatory the removal of links from search engines that make reference to irrelevant or outdated data as per request from any citizen or the person related to the data. So it's vague, it's not precise, and it will certainly be a problem if we legislate this way. There are some others that I'm not going to read to you, but I can make it available. And there is specifically one which is very bad because it creates a call center for the right to be forgotten. So social media companies and internet service providers and websites would be forced to create a call center to receive calls from people demanding information to be deleted from the internet. So when we talk about the right to be forgotten, there are some questions that have to be addressed in order to build a possible, sometimes necessary, but socially possible right to be forgotten. Some of the questions are, is it a new right, or is it is just privacy? Is it forgetting, or is it delinking? Is it about a public or a private person? Is there any public interest in the news, in the information? Can we keep freedom of expression without this information? Is the publication of information necessary? Is it a case of what the French call devoir de mémoire, like the Holocaust, that we need to remember? It's not a case of forgetting, it's impossible to forget. And who is responsible for the content removal? Is a court decision, or is a system of notice and takedown? Well, that's everything I wanted to say. And we have also from the I'm from the Institute for Technology and Society. If you want, you can have books with our analysis of understanding Brazil's Internet Bill of Rights, and in Portuguese, a Charter of Human Rights and Principles for the Internet, which is the translation of the English first version that Marianne drafted and organized the publishing. So Marianne, thank you very much for the opportunity, and thank you again for all the organization on the panel.
Thank you very much, Sergio. Just so we don't forget, thank you very much, Sergio, for crediting me with writing the charter. I would love to take that credit, but seeing as there are expert group drafters of the charter in the room, I won't dare. So it was the Internet Rights and Principles Coalition's efforts that created the charter. But thank you very much, Sergio, for your support in the Brazilian editions. Okay, we're going to move to the next speaker, which is Amishi Chowdhury. And in advance, if Mishi rushes out of the room, it's because she has another commitment. She will be rejoining us, I hope, just to warn you. And she's not running away. She has a double engagement. But Mishi, your 3 minutes starting from now.
Oh, everyone knows Marianne is wonderful, so I'm going to keep my 3 minutes. Staying true to my legal training, I will not be answering the question as posed in the order it is posed, but propose my alternative framing. This is a right to be de-indexed, which we are probably talking about, but now it has taken this really wider meaning. So I do want to put out a few things in front, which is, first thing, humanity has a right to learn and to teach. And without that, there is no other right worth preserving. This crisis of the right to be forgotten, which we are discussing here, or the right to erasure, or whatever you're talking, is a manufactured collision. The only forgetting which actually happens is that internet feels like perpetually going into a room and forgetting what you came in for. Let me also get something out of the way at the very onset. The right to be forgotten is distinct from right to privacy due to the distinction that the right to privacy constitutes information that is not publicly known, whereas the right to be forgotten involves removing information that was publicly known at a certain time and not allowing third parties to access that information. Privacy is crucial if understood to be comprising of secrecy, anonymity, and autonomy. And this right is not about that. And all these rights do not have to be compatible, and conflict between two rights is not detrimental to the survival of the other. The test case for the ECJ's landmark ruling came from Spain, as we heard Pedro talk about, where the right is known, and pardon my Spanish pronunciation, is derecho al olvido. Derecho al olvido. The phrase derecho al olvido carries an odd resonance in Spain. When Francisco died, the country underwent a turbulent transition to democracy. Spaniards were encouraged to look ahead and not to the past for the greater benefit of the public. The unspoken agreement to leave the past behind came to be known as Pacto de Olvido, an agreement to forget. Emilio Silva, the president of the Spanish Association for the Recovery of the Historical Memory, said, "Sure, it sounds great that we all have the chance to cleanse our image, but what are the limits to that?" There are three main points I want to propose. One, the right to be forgotten imposes a corollary duty to forget. And this is thought control and copyright of totalitarianism. Second, the right to be forgotten once allowed goes wild faster than an internet meme. It is as evident by the cumbersome intermediary liability rules imposed by many jurisdictions. We just heard about Brazil. In India, we had to fight a legal battle, and now we have more clarity. But every day, we're fighting this. Third point, unfortunately for those who wish to control the free flow of information, there is one unitary internet. And as long as virtual private networks and proxy browsing is alive, long live the free internet. In January this year, 300 survivors marked the 70th anniversary of liberation of Auschwitz. In their remarks, what they said was, it is our duty, the duty of Europe and world to remember because of those who suffered here, because of you who survived the camp horrors, but it is also our obligation to remember for ourselves and for our future. This duty to forget is thought control of a totalitarian kind, fundamentally in conflict with the freedom of expression, the very essence of free speech and freedom of press. If there is such a right, then somebody must have a duty to forget, the effect of which is so eloquently described by Orwell and his Newspeak. Something which Stalin may do, but George Washington doesn't do that. There are only two, unfortunately, for the proponents of these right to be forgotten. This is not something which I'm proposing a utopia or a dystopia. It is these two things. There is the People's Republic of China, or there is the US celebrated First Amendment. Not because US has all the answers to all the problems about free speech and expression, but they have more experience taking calculated risks in favor of free speech. This also brings me to my second point, that the European ruling may not extend to social media websites, but it does not take much time for these kind of things to go rogue, to go wild. It's a single court decision covering 28 countries, but has already tempted many governments, different countries, many national laws, etc., to now make an internet and balkanize it. And people are going to have a very different access to information than we all right now have. In that case, what happens to the celebrated impact of internet, its potential to educate every brain on earth, to empower every section of the human society? It's called leveling field. I'm told I'm out of time. Sorry, thank you.
You could finish. No, you can finish, come on. One more minute.
What I did want to talk about was the unitary structure of the internet, that there is one net despite the several attempts of governments or data miners to create the walled gardens. This will ensure that such rights with their absurd duties in tow is never effective. Anyone in Europe who wants to use a VPN or a browsing proxy can jump over this phony wall and find the same Spanish public records that they used to find. As long as the US allows some content, the access to that content will be allowed in the world. That means you will always have access to pornography as long as the First Amendment lives, which we hope for everyone's sake is forever. We're living in a world where David Cameron's policy and Xi Jinping's has the same internet policy. But there are own people, the technical experts, who have told them that we should not mess up with the cryptographic rules for the sake of the internet, for free speech and expression. When software freedom is ubiquitous and when the technical people have hacked these rights, we're just going to have enough privacy and also free speech and expression. So this right to be forgotten, de-index, should just be buried at the very onset. Thank you. Thanks for the extra minute.
The exception does not prove the rule. I will now move to Kelly Kim. Thank you very much, Kelly. Your 3 or so minutes are starting now.
It might take 4 minutes. I will be very fast. I'm substituting Professor K.S. Park. So he's the expert on rights to be forgotten. Anyways, so this discussion on right to be forgotten is very important, especially in Korea, as the Korea Communication Commission, which is like FCC of Korea, is considering adopting a right to be forgotten law since the ECJ Google Spain decision came out. So it hasn't been particularly successful yet, but we are worried that we might become the first country to have right to be forgotten statute on, well, it's on top of like rigorous online censorship carried out by an administrative agency called the Korea Standard Communications Standard Commission, which is already taking many lawful contents down whenever it is necessary for nurturing sound communication ethics. So a standard as vague and amorphous as the standard used by the Google Spain decision, which is like excessive, absolute, and irrelevant. So data protection law in general defines personal information as information related to a living individual and gives a data subject the power to control his or her personal data. So a tenet that one owns data about him or her and therefore should have control over that data sounds good, but is not always sustainable and compatible with respect for others' freedom of thoughts and expressions. So for example, like Kelly Kim is a lawyer, is a data about me, and that is known to many already. And the question is, when and under what grounds can I control this perfectly lawful data about myself that resides in other people's heads that is non-defamatory and non-privacy infringing? Well, so Google Spain case was one answer to that question, which we consider more or less lousy. One reason is that the information de-indexed, which was a hyperlink, was already publicly available data, which was published in this newspaper, Vanguardia. So applying data protection law on such information is against its original purpose. I mean, because the data protection law was meant to protect data that are not publicly available, and thus within the privacy zone. So, I mean, we wanted to protect privacy through data protection law. We should not protect people's desire to wipe out unfavorable or embarrassing information about themselves. So let me give you an example on how right to be forgotten can be abused. So Korea became independent of 36 years of Japanese colonial rule in 1948. So many Korean people collaborated with the colonial administration and exploited fellow Koreans. The issue is current because unlike Germany or France, there has been no government-sponsored efforts to indict and bring justice to those collaborators who number in like tens of thousands. And many were not public figures during the colonial periods. So some of them are like officers and civil servants who carried out the military logistics and tactics of the Japanese invasion through Asia, which reached as far as Myanmar. So now there has been an NGO-led effort to keep an encyclopedia of these Korean collaborators. And of course, the collaborators and their descendants are of contesting this effort. So in this case, if we had a right to be forgotten law, in sense of Google Spain, any links to the encyclopedia or the entries themselves may be required to be taken down for the reason that their past wrongdoings are now obsolete because it was like more than a half a century ago. So we should stop talking about data ownership and start talking about privacy. And right to be forgotten should not be applied to data that are publicly available, although it is about an individual. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Very clear final statement. Thank you. I'd now like to turn to our last two speakers for their 3 minutes plus or minus. Mr. Pedro Vaca from the Foundation for Freedom of the Press.
Thank you. Okay, I would like to introduce the Colombian case, that it's the one we're thinking on about the right to be forgotten. And the case is like this. A citizen identified as Gloria asked the newspaper El Tiempo to remove from search engines, specifically Google, an article from 2000 year about arrest of several people for human trafficking. Gloria was not convicted. The case was closed with favorable outcome for Gloria. When the statute of limitation expired, Gloria stated that the news article appeared whenever she typed her name in that search engine, causing her employment and financial difficulties. How was resolved the case by the Constitutional Court in Colombia? The court found that easy access to the news article affected the citizen's right to honor. For this reason, the court decided that when there is a favorable outcome for an individual involved in a legal proceeding, it is necessary to update the information and make searches more difficult, but do not delete the information. According to the court, the media outlet must respond to the request and, if it's necessary, delete the content from search engines so that the information is updated and remains online but cannot be accessed through search engines. This rule does not apply for people with a high public profile or public servants or in cases of crimes against humanity or human rights violation. Take into account that this criteria might be contradictory with the case because we are talking about human trafficking that is considered as a human rights violation. We work with press freedom issues, so this is for us, takes into account like two legal challenges, let's say. The first one is that we should take into account long-standing legal debates on the tensions between freedom of expression and other rights. I'm a little bit scared of one. Judiciary is taking these cases, they're like creating new rules regardless the long time debates about the tensions between it's normal tensions between freedom of expression and other rights, defamation, children's rights, freedom of information, freedom of opinion, etc. The very name Right to be Forgotten seems to ignore aspects such as public interest, the right to memory, very important in countries with armed conflict like mine, or free flow of ideas. Societies might have made enormous effort to recognize that disagreement is desirable in a democracy, in a democracy, and that the right to be forgotten, talking about a theoretical speaking without referring it to any specific case, is a justification for enforcing a single point of view where those who want to forget or be forgotten impose a collective amnesia on those around them about an issue that may be of public interest. Behind the cases involving the right to be forgotten, there are initiatives that for years have been fighting for certain rights. I defend the right to freedom of expression, and there's people who defend children's rights, and that's okay. The various communities taking part in this debate must encourage discussion and be willing to discuss and assess the difficult cases that may be arise. The greatest risk is based on one particular case. If we let that particular case become a general rule, may be implemented that priorize on set of rights over another. It is essential to be willing to convince and be convinced on a case-by-case basis. The impartiality of judges has never been as important as now.
Oh, okay, brilliant. Okay. Thank you very much, Pedro. Very important points. So I turn to our last speaker for the first set of our statements, Hernan Valles from the UN High Commission for Human Rights. Thank you very much, Hernan.
Yeah, thank you, Marianne. Okay, in my 3 minutes, I would like to make 3 points. The first one will be about the current situation on the right to be forgotten. The second point will be about the right to know the truth, which is alluded somehow and many times, but it's not really developed a lot. at least in the things that I have read. And finally, I would like to make reference to the need to always have a judge involved when making decisions about the right to be forgotten. So about the first point, the current situation, when researching a little bit the issue, I was struck by the confusion that is out there. There are different draft laws, and there are laws that are being approved, for example, the law in Russia, and there are different judicial decisions in different jurisdictions. And they all go in, they all cite and seem to be inspired in the Costeja case, but they don't all necessarily follow, which is not necessarily a bad thing, don't get me wrong. But my point is, there seems to be a confusion that might need some kind of guidance. For example, there is some legislation, a project I saw from Chile, or the legislation in Russia, and some decisions that make intermediaries liable. Some other decisions seem to make intermediaries not liable. Some decisions consider that past criminal records are important and cannot be forgotten. Some decisions don't. Some jurisdictions require a court order or an expert opinion to request a delisting. Some other jurisdictions don't. So again, I see that there is a lot of different opinions out there, and that before, as Michi said, before this right to be forgotten goes rogue, it might need some kind of parameters on how it should work. The second point is about the right to know the truth. I think we all know that, and this has been alluded by other speakers as well, that historical information on gross human rights violations is very important. It's very important to prevent those violations from being forgotten and to prevent those violations from ever repeating themselves. This is part of human rights law and it has been recognized and is contained in a distinct right, the right to know the truth, or the right to know, or right to the truth, or right to memory. It has different names, they all mean the same. As I said, this is a distinct right. It's part of international human rights law and it has been recognized now in several international instruments. Lately, for example, in the Convention Against Enforced Disappearances. But what does it mean? Well, basically, the right to know the truth entitles victims, their relatives, and the public at large to seek and obtain information concerning the commission of a human rights violation. So it has basically two aspects. One aspect is it is a collective right, and it ensures society has access to information about its past. Information that is essential in democratic systems. And if I may quote the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, the court said, every society has the inalienable right to know the truth about past events. It cannot be said clearer than this. A second aspect of the right to know the truth is it is also a private right. It's a right of victims, and in this regard, and relatives, and in this regard, it affords a form of compensation. Yeah, it is also a way for victims to get closure, for victims to get, for people to acknowledge what happened to them. That is a form of compensation, and this has also been recognized by the Inter-American Court in the Parada versus El Salvador case. So what is my concern? My concern is that as the right to be forgotten starts developing very quickly, it might happen that we start allowing for uncontrolled erasure of information, and that this will surely have a negative impact on the right to truth and on the right to accountability. We will not be able to take people to court. And this is not about past events. Gross human rights violations are happening now as we speak. They're happening in Burundi. They're happening in Myanmar. So it's current. It's not only about the Holocaust or the dictatorships in Latin America. Finally, am I doing fine with the time? Okay, finally, and let me underline, finally, I said I wanted to say why the involvement of a judge is important. I mean, not all cases related to right to be forgotten may involve gross human rights violation and be in contradiction with the right to know the truth, but all cases will have an impact on freedom of expression. Now, we all know that freedom of expression can be restricted, and it can be restricted for the protection of the rights or reputation of others, but to do that, we need to follow a three-part test. In particular, there is a tricky part of this test, the part on the proportionality, and I think this balancing, this proportionality test, needs to be done by a judge, or at the very least, by a trained, qualified ombudsperson. This is not for a private company to do. So I think the decision of in the Costeja case in this regard was mistaken. That's it. That's my 3 points. Thank you.
All right. I'm just looking at the clock here. It's running at just under 50 minutes, 50 minutes. Now, I have a feeling we have some very expert and knowledgeable people in the room. I can see I would like, if that's okay with everyone, if we go to the breakout groups now, because then we have time to come back and do some more statements. And is that okay? Yes. Yeah? So allow me to explain how it's going to work. We're going to just break it very quickly into six groups. I will define the group according to where you're sitting in the room. So if you want to get out of here, do so now. We said we had four objectives, but I have a feeling that we might need to just try and focus on two for the purposes of the discussion. But of course, you can ignore my suggestions. The four objectives are on the workshop outline on the schedule, the live schedule, but I thought perhaps it's about actually brainstorming a more appropriate name for these sorts of decisions for the sake of figuring out what it is we're actually talking about really, given the comments we've just had. And secondly, if possible, to come up with one or two recommendations following on from our speakers for future rulings by this given new name. All right? That might be more than enough. Would people agree? Of course, you can ignore that and just talk about something that is relevant. And then our speakers are going to be the rapporteurs for the groups that they are moderating. Okay? So I'm thinking we have to get some more. 20 minutes maximum. So this is how I'm going to do it. This first half of the room up to the gentleman in the green shirt, just back, Sergio will moderate. So just gather and just stay where you are. Then from his left into the corner there, that will be Kelly, okay? And then the last half of that back section will be Hinnan, the back part. Okay, so one, two, three. And then we're up to Milton, or Sono, up to, say, Ricky. And behind her is five. See, people leaving the room already. And that will be... Pedro, and six, Pedro again, will take this section with Carmen and back. So just 20 minutes, brainstorm and come back. I think this is a way we can crack open the discussion and keep awake. You might have to release yourselves from your screen. Thanks for participating. We'll join back in 20 minutes. Just in the room, just huddle around. Think we can manage that? Yep. Thank you for trying it out. Hi, everyone. I'm sorry to interrupt. But if you could wrap it up in about a minute and reconvene with the seats back in the places they were before, please. Time. Our group moderators, could you wrap it up and could we reconvene, please? Pedro. Please return the seats to the original positions because our room monitors are extremely concerned about this. We need to respect that rule. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, everyone. Are the seats all back in the original position? Okay, we have 15 minutes to hear back from the groups.
This was super fun.
Yeah, it is fun, isn't it, when people do it. It's such a great energy.
We should do all the IGF this.
Just bullet point report back. Bullet point. Bullet point. So it gets up on the transcript because we're brainstorming. This is the first time we've had a session like this. So we can.
That was such a good idea.
I know. Trust me, I know what I'm doing. All right. It's a great way to diffuse the anger I'm feeling over this other rubbish today. Okay, good. Okay. Right. Thank you very much. That was such a great energy in the room. You were really impressive for me. I was standing around. Fabulous. I've taken some photos. Do I have people's permission? If you think your photo's been taken by me, please come and tell me if you do not wish it to be up there because it will never be forgotten. Okay. Right, we're going to start now. We have 15 minutes.
or so, maybe 20 minutes max, so you can all get to the next session. Is it 10 till 10:30 this session or till 10:45? I'm a bit confused. Till 10:30. Okay, we're just going to start at the end of the table, move down. Kelly, are you there? Great. And the rapporteurs, formerly known as the panelists, will report back in brief bullet points the main outcome of the discussion. Now remember, we're not trying to resolve this morning. We're trying to change the conversation and get more precision about what we're talking about. So beginning with Sergio, your group, please.
Thank you, Marianne. It was an amazing, tough, but amazing experience. And, the group couldn't even decide if there was such a thing as the right to be forgotten. The majority thought that in some circumstances we could claim this right to be forgotten. But five people were completely against the possibility of such right. It shouldn't exist at all. But considering the people who believe that there is such a thing as the right to be forgotten, two or three things were very important. First, if there is such right, it's the court decision, the only entity, the court is the only entity to have the power to remove the content from the internet. We should not privatize this duty. So private entities such as Google's or Google or any other website would not be the entities to address these quests, these requirements of removal. Second, the relevance of the information is the most important thing for us to evaluate when there is the claim to remove the content. Another problem would be the territory, the extraterritorial enforcement of decisions, which really is a problem. And finally, we discussed the name and we agree that the name, the right to be forgotten, is not the best one. It should be the right to be the indexed or the linked, but not the right to be forgotten. So that was how far we could go. Thank you.
That sounds like a very long way. Thank you very much. Moving to Kelly's group, what did you come up with? Thank you.
Just in one word, complicated. So we spend about most of our time on finding the appropriate name. And I think we have found one. The best one was like right not to be found on intermediaries. I don't know what others in the room would think about this new name we come up with. And we talked about right to be de-indexed or right to be de-linked or right to be erased. There was a comment on right to be erased that it is very misleading because the information is existing somewhere online and can be found. So right to be erased should be crossed out. But right to be de-indexed, and there was opinion that it's only de-indexed if the name is used as a keyword. So you can just find the person, find the information by using other keywords. So even right to be de-indexed is not that appropriate. So right not to be found, we reached an agreement on right not to be found on intermediaries as our appropriate name for right to be forgotten. There was a comment on this Argentinian case where a girl requested Google and other intermediaries to delete pornographic contents which she had taken when she was like a minor, and her request got accepted. But the interesting thing is, nothing can be found online about her. If you search her name online, search her name on Google, like nothing's found, no images found. So it was interesting. And there was another interesting discussion on the new generation kids like whose photos or information are posted online, like on Facebook and on Twitter, by their parents, and what kind of rights should they be given, or what kind of rights should be recognized for them? But like, we didn't reach an agreement on whether the rights should be recognized, but it wasn't. It was very interesting. And recommendation for future rulings. We definitely think that judicial review or intervention should be required, and legal information or legality of information or publication should be reviewed.
Thank you very much. This is all going up on the transcript so people can refer to it. I just want to note that the Syracuse University Remote Hub will also be responding from their breakout session in Upper New York State. So, is that right? Upper New York State, did I get it right? And we may have an intervention from Julia Powles, who was going to be with us. She's told me on Twitter that we've forgotten some things. So, turning to Henan, your group.
Yeah, our 20-25 minutes went by very fast, and we had interesting discussions. In terms of the name, we thought that the right to be forgotten is a name that caught up in the media very easily, but apparently the academic world has stopped using it, and now the name it's being used more widely is the right to be delisted. I asked if right to be delinked would be better, but I kind of was convinced that maybe delisted is better. Another point we discuss is there are cases and cases about right to be forgotten. Some are easier, some are more complicated. But in this complicated world where we live in, one person was making this point of it's difficult to find out now who is a public person. And we used to have people that were prominent and public and in power, and people that were not, just common people. But now this distinction has a little bit, it's not so clear anymore, which complicates things for deciding whether information is in the public interest or not. Another point we discussed was the right of delisting versus amending. Some people were of the view that sometimes by amending the information that is in the originator information, that would be enough. You don't need to take links out. We also agreed that in principle, it shouldn't be search engines having to take down this information, but someone warned or at least raised the issue that courts are traditionally very slow, and also, he posed questions on whether they would have the capacity to react in a meaningful time to these kind of requests. That's it, thanks.
Okay, the time factor has been brought up, but that is an important point. Okay, moving to our last two rapporteurs. First of all, Pedro, and then Pedro. Thank
you. Glimmer Twins. Okay, so very active discussion. Thanks for the group. It was very, very enriching. So first we identified that we need to separate this concept of right to the index versus the erasure or the deleting of the content. We see that delinking is leading a lot to also content removal. That was a point made by many of the members, where Christina from representing the libraries has made a very good point around this. Also, we discuss different bills and case law in Brazil that also present several challenges, and where we can find a trend more oriented to remove content, and sometimes also uninformed judicial decisions that end up removing content that might be important for the public, such things around corruption. Also mentions other bills like Chile's bill on right to be forgotten that provide also extending the right to be forgotten not only to search engines but to websites. Then also it was made a point where that it is clear that there is a problem. There is people that is suffering for this, and that the such large amount of requests that search engines receive on this issue is an evidence of that. We all agree that this problem needs a solution, but we we think that we don't agree in the implementation that the ruling set for it. And we think that this is not the best way, or we agree that this is not the best way to implement the solution to this problem. It also was pointed out that if and it was a question if whether this ruling also imposed an obligation not only to delink false information, and whether it is difficult or easy for search engines to decide what is false or what is true. We, in that regard, we also point out which was the guideline given by the tribunal, the court, about what should be delink, and it's about information that information that should be erased. That is considered insufficient, irrelevant, not relevant, or excessive. That was the guideline. In terms of the implementation of this, of the solution of this problem, there was agreement that the ideal way will be through involve the judiciary. On the decision making of this, though it also was pointed out that given that this could lead to a lot of requests, and in order to get faster solutions, could be also an option to involve administrative authorities with clear mandate, so they can also resolve these issues faster in a faster way. And last, we also discussed about the naming. And we agree. We agree that maybe the linking is a more accurate term for this. However, the right to be forgotten shows the impact that this could have on other human rights involved. So technically, the linking is more accurate, but in some point diminished, which is the impact that this has on other rights, because it reduces the discussion to such a technical thing. So that's it.
Okay, thank you very much. Important point, yes. And final reporting back, because we also have Syracuse and also have some points that need to be raised via Twitter from Julia Powells. So, Pedro?
I'll go very, very quickly. First of all, there was a discussion, and I think the group believed that there is not a right to be forgotten, but there's a tension and some specific challenges for resolve or to solve it online. And talking about how to name it, it's the linking or the listing. I don't know if I'm missing another concept. About the claims, in those specific cases, we talk about the demonstration of a real ongoing harm and also to demonstrate in which jurisdiction is relevant. We talk about that there's some cases, I mean, about personal data and the case in the Colombian tribunal. And a couple of issues, search engines or internet companies remove contents and also fight against the right to be forgotten. And someone suggests that probably is a contradictory position on the same topic. And because of the time, I think it's better if we share.
Right, thank you very much. Now, we have about 8 minutes left, which is time to hear from the Syracuse remote hub, the remote participant moderator. Do they have any points they wish to bring to the table? But before then, I'd like to ask, Julia Powells has been active from Australia. Just a brief note for the record, the late Casper Bowden was going to join us. So this panel is very much in the spirit of Casper, and Julia wants to intervene at this point. So Gree, can you read her points out, and then we'll cut to Syracuse.
Yeah, I've become the messenger because I got a direct message on Twitter with 3 points from Julia Powells from University of Cambridge. She says, one, Pedro of Google talks of the great burden requiring hundreds and hundreds of professionals. How many people are working at Google on this? Note to everyone, Google is completely opaque about its processes and anything more than gross statistics. Once you consider the acceptance rate has stayed absolutely stable over time, it suggests decision making by quota. But it is disingenuous for Google to say that this is a great burden and not disclose details of how and why it is such a burden, or to say it privatizes decision making and then willfully make it completely opaque. Two, Misha and Kelly are concerned about precedent setting, but totalitarian regimes don't need a precedent to censor the internet. Google doesn't need a precedent to make private information on the world's citizens public. What precedent do citizens have apart from Costesia's case for resurrecting a shred of privacy online? Three, the emphasis of Herman and Pedro of free press on gross human rights violations and freedom of expression show how problematic it is that we are not facing the reality of actual right to be forgotten request. The vast majority, and that is 95% on the basis of leaked info, of which are extremely mundane requests to obscure someone's medical history, address, childhood embarrassment, and so on. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Julia. Thank you. Thank you, Kaspar. Right, at Syracuse, I think they have some brief points to make so we can then move to summing up. The Syracuse students, anything from them, or they might be still talking? We can't hear you. Thank you very much for participating. If you have more to offer, perhaps you can send them through so we can have them on a text form. Thank you very much. Thank you. Right. Now, we have 5 minutes remaining. I'm hearing from the floor that a lot of people have some points they want to raise. But I think to respect time and the next panel that will have to begin at 11, which I have to be in, and I've been told I'll be told off if I'm not there on time, and we all need coffee. I'd like to ask our panelists to, in one sentence, Mishi, welcome back, one sentence, provide a takeaway for us. And those of you who have specific comments to panelists are welcome to come up and talk to them directly. And we will continue this conversation this afternoon in 1:42. But we'll start with Pedro first and go the other way. And if Mishi can think of one sentence, so that you can just get a sense, not right away because you've just come in. So Pedro, one sentence, your takeaway.
We acknowledge that it's a problem that people is suffering about this. What is clear is that we are not dealing with the right way to solve this problem, and there is a lot of room for improvement here and to find other ways that balance better all the different human rights involved in making a solution for these issues.
By the way, that was Pedro speaking on behalf of Google, is that correct? Okay, correct. Thank you, Pedro. Pedro from the Freedom of Press Association in Colombia.
I would like to suggest an hypothesis. I mean, if in very close to criminal issue, more than other cases, if a society have agreed that people who break the law are sentenced to, for example, 4 years of prison, this must be the only applicable social sanction. Finding information and discriminating against someone who has through a legal proceeding entails extending the sanction beyond what society has agreed upon through laws. I have my doubts about whether the right to be forgotten or to delete negative information about a person on the internet contributes to understanding as a society the scope of sanction.
Thank you. So, Kelly, one sentence for a takeaway.
Google Spain decision is definitely lousy, and I think everybody kind of have an agreement on that point. And ECJ didn't consider how their decision right to be forgotten can be abused in other, how to say, less democratic or less developed countries. So that was disappointing.
Thank you very much. And Mishi, one sentence from where you're sitting. One sentence.
Okay. It can have parts and phrases.
Lawyer, so there'll be one with lots of commas. All right, okay.
So when free speech and expression are enabled by private players, things are going to get a little different than when it was just the state one had to deal with. So we will have a lot of these hiccups, etc. But we have to be watchful because this can lead to censorship by proxy and also burden on a private player, which should be left to the courts of each jurisdiction. For this right to be forgotten, I hope it gets forgotten by more speech, which will ensure that optimization or de-optimization of search engine results are done by more speech than by more erasures.
Thank you, Mishi. Thank you very much. Henan, Commissioner for Human Rights.
Can it be like one paragraph instead of one sentence? Okay.
Oh, one sentence. Two commas only.
My comment would be a right to be delisted. Obviously, it has merits, but it needs to be further discussed and delineated. We must define criteria for applying the right, criteria for the proportionality test, explore further the meaning of irrelevant, inadequate, excessive information. And in this regard, I wanted to say that it is always in the public interest to be able to access information about human rights violations. Information about past violations, knowing the truth, is essential to accountability and to fight impunity. It allows victims and relatives to gain a sense of closure and receive acknowledgement of their suffering, and it is a vital step in preventing a recurrence of the events that led to the violations in the first place. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Hanan. Important point. Sergio, final comment?
Well, I think to reach consensus is absolutely impossible in this subject. But if there is a consensus, I don't think it's not even in the position that everything should be erased, nor that nothing should be erased. Because I think we have to protect society and its memory and its history, but we also in certain cases need to protect human people and their privacy and, in the words of Professor Rodotà, the relevance of the information that is available. So I think the middle ground is where we, if we cannot find consensus, is where we can find a best solution. Thank you.
And with that, we now rechristen these rulings rights to be delisted, delinked, de-indexed, and to be remembered for those new issues that we are broaching. Thank you very much, everyone. You've been fabulous. Goodbye. Enjoy your coffee. See you this afternoon.